You know, you can either be afraid or you can be happy. You can't be happy and afraid at the same time. I can't think of any situation in which you can be happy and afraid at the same time and you're not able to describe this. Second thing they found is invariably in such experiences, they are not able to describe either space or time. They can't say, I was here or I was in such and such place for 5 minutes, I was in such and such place for 10 minutes. No, there's no time there. Time fails once they go to that level. There is a complete language breakdown. What we used to communicate here is nothing compared to what apparently happens there because we don't know. And there is an intuitive understanding which predominates during this. There is no need for speaking. They understand intuitively. So these were the four core elements which they described in all these experiences, having studied a lot of people who went through them. And in their paper, they put up these points. Very nice, because it helps us to differentiate between abnormality versus normal here. Mystical states, the people who go through them are always joyful, they are ecstatic. They welcome the separation form. They really look forward to these experiences more and more. And they share their experiences coherently. They function very effectively in society. And they become more humble and intuitive. This is by far and large what is found of these people. Whereas in people who really have mental illnesses and who have these kind of hallucinations or grandiose behavior, they are distressed, they are frightened, they are angry, reproachful, suspicious. They have all the negative emotions going along with that. Withdrawal is involuntary and continuous, and grandiose behavior with lack of insight. These were the criteria by which they were able to differentiate, and this paper was published in 1997. So conclusions from studies which have been done so far, hundreds of studies, lots of studies have been done on the spiritual practices. Only two conclusions we can draw at present. Definitely, these kind of spiritual practices enhances longevity and personal health. That has been shown beyond doubt in a lot of papers now. And there is definite evidence to show that there is shedding of negative emotions and improvement in intellectual function in all these subjects. And now these eight techniques which I am going to show are not by some kind of motivational speaker or a corporate guru, but this is from a paper by Andrew Newberg from Massachusetts. In increasing order of effectiveness, eight techniques which resemble spiritual practices, which produce the same effects, and they have studied these in terms of fMRI. Eight best. Smile. He says smile, and this is something which is given not as a scientific fact in a paper. Of course, there is a paper on this, but he has also written it up in his book, How God Changes Your Brain. Smile. So smiling definitely produces positive effects. All of us know that. But here he makes a differentiation between smiling and laughing. He says smiling is not the same as laughing, because laughing sometimes increases your negative emotions. So laughing is not good. Be intellectually active, consciously relax, that is not being a couch potato but doing something like this, yawning, he says yawning is almost as good as meditation, and meditation of various types, this is the modern day meditation, aerobic exercises, dialogue with others, and he says the best, and this is something which was really surprising to me, coming from a neurologist. The first is faith. He says, have faith. So therefore, the fundamental nature of the reality is still uncertain. It remains an enigma. And we need to have an open-minded acceptance of all these findings if we are to go forward. The brain may be an instrument of consciousness rather than the producer of consciousness. And science and spirituality must be integrated to become the science of spirituality in future. And this is a good statement to conclude. This is a photo of Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, which was one of the pioneers in death and near-death studies. She said, I think we have reached an era of transition in our society. We have to have the courage to open new doors and admit that our present-day scientific tools are inadequate for many of these new investigations. This is a verse from the Rig Veda. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vasudevan. That was one big lecture I never thought I would listen to today. Thank you so much. It's a great lecture. Thank you. Thank you. And no. Fantastic. I'm so overwhelmed that I don't really have the words. I'm in a spiritual experience. Okay, so let's kickstart the discussion today. And when you discuss, please introduce yourself and direct the questions at one of the speakers that you want to ask questions on. Thank
you. I'm supposed to moderate, but maybe I'll have a few words as well. This is in fact to set in motion the question time. First of all, I thank Dr. Yogaraj and Vasu for asking me to come here. I have a lot of disclosures. First of all, I'm an ill-fit in this scenario. I didn't know what this topic meant, nor did I know what I was supposed to do. However, the topic, as many have told me, it was so captive and attractive. At the time they called me, I didn't know even the title of the topic. I only knew that there was going to be a discussion, that it is beyond the brain, I came to know later. And it was very captive and attractive. And whatever I am going to say will be totally off what esteemed colleagues, Professor Tyagarajan and Professor Vasudevan said. Those were all researched and well-read articles. I didn't do any research, I didn't do any reading, but I'm just going to say what comes from a common man and leave it to the neurologists and the whoever the scientists, to tell where this all comes from. Basically, the concept to me beyond the brain, of course, the brain has to be there, and then we'll have to move beyond the brain. Brain, of course, we know the function. The medical people, as well as the neurologists, know the brain. We know what is the anatomy, we know what is the physiology, we know all about the anatomy, physiology. We leave alone pathology. We are not going to discuss pathological issues here or the abnormal brain here. We are going to talk about only the normal brain. So once we are left with that and we go beyond the brain, now what lies beyond the brain? To me, what lies beyond the brain? I mean, this is elementary, basic, simple. Please pardon me if I'm going to talk about these things in this scenario. To me, beyond the brain is the mind. Now, what is the mind? What does the mind do? Okay, I talked about brain. It's physiological, anatomical functions. Okay, it makes me perform. And then beyond the brain, the mind, when I say mind, what is the mind does to me? The mind is the one which gives me instruction or which gives the brain what it has to do. In whatever spheres you may take, in all the spheres that has been discussed, what I am supposed to do or is from the mind. What I think, in other words, how I approach a problem, how I deal with it, how I have to go about it. It may be empathy, it may be social cognition, it may be conscience, it may be religious practices, what I do, how I do, everything has to come from the mind. So mind is there. Mind is the one which makes the brain function. All this, of course, is you're open for commenting, criticizing, whatever it is, you can do that. So mind comes above the brain. There is something called the mind, and where it is, what it does, of course, mind also has to come from our experiences, and it has to come from parts of the brain which they have already alluded to. Basically, it's going to be the prefrontal lobe, prefrontal cortex, it has to be the limbic brain, it has to be the superior temporal gyrus, the medial temporal gyrus, all those areas which Vasu pointed out, superior parietal lobe, all these parts, yes, they take part. But what we have listed there are functions, fMRIs. You do an activity, at that time you found that these areas are hyperactive or hypoactive. That's fine. I decide and these actions become hyperactive or hypoactive. But what makes me decide? How do I decide? Why should I differ from Yogaraj or Vasu in my decisions? Why does my mind differ from them? So what is that so-called mind and how do we go about? Of course, all that was mentioned about our genetics, our environment, our brought up, everything has to play a role. But again, that gives only instructions, and what we are showing here, which area is activated, that's all. The same applies to spirituality also, we'll come to that. So that's about the mind. Coming to the spirit. See, we rather use spiritual, religious, all sort of interchangeably, and adu aanmeegam. Pardon me for speaking in Tamil, it doesn't matter. ஆன்மீக விஷயம் பேசுகிறாங்க, ஸ்பிரிச்சுவல் விஷயம் பேசுகிறாங்க. அஸ்தோ இட் டசன்ட் பிலாங் டு அஸ். ஸ்பிரிச்சுவல் ஆன்மீகம் இஸ் பார்ட் ஆஃப் அஸ். We may not go into it, we may not think about it, we may not talk about it. And this is one forum, probably, where we should talk about it. We have not ventured into these areas. These are grey areas. When I came up with you, when you thought beyond the brain, it is these areas which are not discussed. It is those areas we need to concentrate upon, at least discuss amongst ourselves, before taking it further, what to do, how to do. I mean, whether we are competent to do, whether we how to pursue with this. Yes. Now, once that comes in, then of course, this is what is happening today. We are trying to blend the spiritual practices, the mysticism, the philosophies of the East with the Western scientific techniques to find out whether there can be an establishment on scientific basis. And that is the work which is being done, and that is where fMRIs, MEGs have a lot of role in this, to see what the waveforms are in people who do constant medications. And in fact, in them, the frequencies, at least at the time of medications, is beyond. It's beyond 130, 140 hertz, which is happening. These are proven facts. And in fact, MEG picks up those. So something is happening during those periods. Of course, Vasu told about this Tibetan monks and French nuns. Yes, that's all well worked up work, which is mentioned in the, which everybody refers to whenever they talk about spirituality. Now, talking about spirituality and religion, I don't think the two are same. They cannot be used interchangeably. Religion is something different, spirituality is something different. He talked about not being religious and spiritual. Yes, of course. You don't need to follow a religion to be spiritual. What is spiritual then? Spirit is what lies in you. That is something which is you. Now, if you are going to talk about consciousness, then we come to the word consciousness, defining the word consciousness. Consciousness is there, super consciousness is there, cosmic consciousness is there. There may be many more which I don't know. I haven't thought about it. Cosmic consciousness may be the world three, which Prabhakar Tyagarajan said, whatever is around us. But world two could be conscious, yourself, your soul. Now, what is spirit? What is soul? What is religiosity? What is piety? For some reason, we obviously omit piety out of all this. And so on, so is religious. I've heard in several, when we talk of so-and-so, when we read the biography of so-and-so, or when we read say about so-and-so, so-and-so is a very religious person. No, it's not religious. So-and-so is a pious person. It's not a religious person. So we need to make all these differences between piety, religious, spiritual. Coming back to religion is somewhere low down compared to spirituality. Piety is somewhere in between, okay. Spirituality is totally different. Spiritual means that is what takes you to super consciousness. Now, what is consciousness? I am here in Hotel Savera in Olive Hall at around 4:45 p.m. talking to a host of educated people, neurologists and others, and I am talking on this subject. That is consciousness. Now, what is super consciousness? Again, it differs from, see, the entire topic gives different, conjures different thoughts in different people, and each person may have different connotations to it. But what would I say? What is super consciousness? Who am I? Na yaar? Na enga irundhu vandha? Edhukku vandha? Na enga poran? Enna pannano? That is super consciousness. You go beyond a conscious level. And again, see, why it becomes under consciousness? It is part of you. You are analyzing yourself. And so it becomes conscious. But it is beyond the realms of normal consciousness which we are talking about. It takes us entirely into a separate sphere. And that sphere is where spirit comes. That is spiritual. Whether we believe there is something, a spirit or a soul, it's, we talked about out-of-body experiences. So beyond the body, there is something else. So that is an entire another sphere, out-of-body, death, near-death experiences. We'll come to that. I'll see if time permits. That is what Nalla, this Mirabai, even Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, Vivekananda, they all had that out-of-body experience. They just walked away, not knowing where they are and what they were doing. At that moment of time, they were out of body. And near death is something different because it might be close to dreams. It is all something which you had experienced already. That is how you can focus on near death. It may be a hallucination, it may be a dream, we don't have words for it. But it is an experience which you have already been through. So that is near death. Coming to spirituality, that it is supposed to take you, that spirit is within you, and whether you believe in birth, rebirth, whatever it is, there is a spirit, and that spirit is coming to physics, metaphysics, particles, photons. It may be neutrino. I mean, you give whatever term, whatever name you want to give. They are particles. Anyway, the spirit is there. And that spirit comes from the origin, whatever be it. And that linking of the spirit is what we are supposed to do or what we should do. The spirit has to reach back. If we believe or whatever it is, if we believe in a spirit, that is what is a spirit. And so you enter into those practices. Why I am talking about this? This has meaning to what Vasu said. We come back now to the temporal lobes. In people who are meditating, it has been shown that the temporal lobes are hyperactive. You want to concentrate, again, your prefrontal cortex has to do. You meditate, you concentrate on a point. It may be chanting, it may be hearing, or it may be focusing. Each one has a different area. It's basically increase in activity in one area and suppression of activity in another area, the parietal area, when you don't want it, when you want to shut off yourself. So this is what is happening. And when you do these spiritual practices, what happens is you go into a state where it is an enjoyable state. You enter into a state, probably what people say they've been to God, they see God, is they go into that state where they feel that they are merged or they are with the God. That's a feeling. It's not a continuous phase. They come back into reality again. But basically this again has been shown to arise from the temporal lobe. Gentle stimulation, what I'm saying is scientific now. Gentle stimulation of the temporal lobes are supposed to give a very pleasant euphoric state where this is what you enjoy. And that is what probably has been alluded to as the place where you see people who are in that state don't want to come out of that state, so they want to keep on meditating, keep on practicing that meditation. You give whatever name you want, go into that state where they can be in that state where they can enjoy that whatever gives enjoyment to them and continue to be in that state. So that is what meditation or spiritual practices leads you to, and that again arises from temporal lobes, and it's a gentle stimulation of the temporal lobes. Probably by the process of meditation, we learn and tune ourselves to gently stimulate. See, again, the more you do meditation, the more you practice, the more easily you get into it. Very easily, quickly you move into it. You don't take time. In other words, it's a phenomena you have done. You operated the circuit again and again, and so the moment you want, you go into it. And what better than the state which you enjoy? I mean, there maybe we can even say there is no hell or heaven. The heaven is here. Once you go into that state, you are in heaven. Once you come out and think of other things, probably you are in hell. I'm just speculating, saying that everything is within you. And that is what everybody says. It is self-realization. In other words, realize yourself. Self-realization is the ultimate. And self-realization means you have to do the soul. You become a super conscious being apart from this conscious level. I think I would stop with that. And probably discussion can go on and others can contribute. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Probably I am the senior most speaker or member here. I passed my MD from MMC in 1965, 1 or 2 years senior to Vel Murugan. And then I had a very close brush with neurology. I was working with Dr. B. Ramamurthy, though I was on the medical side. I used to run behind him because he will give important clues when we least expect it. So, and another person I was close with was Dr. K. Jagannathan. With him, until he died, I was very close. because we live close to each other, and he used to like me. In the meantime, I had gone to Newcastle upon Tyne and worked with Professor Walter, John Walton, for 1 year. And when I returned, Professor Jagarathan said, no, no, you leave general medicine and come to neurology. But I was hesitating. Then my MD chief, the postgraduate teacher, Dr. Sam J.P. Moses, said, Susikaran is okay if you like neurology, but if you stay in general medicine, you can help more people. That advice appealed to me. Now, I see you are all probably my juniors, so excuse me if I offend you. I see sincerity and competence in this group. So please keep it up. My own view is, fear is acknowledged by religions, number one. Spirituality is hope, number two. Spirituality is an experience, and it cannot be explained. Spirituality is singular. One person is spiritual. While religions are plural. There is some exhibition there. And religion is a practice. Spirituality, I already said, is an experience. Now, Dr. Radhakrishnan, our former president, said that man is not the final product of creation. Man is in the process of creation still. Now, these are the steps through which we are evolving. I see a glimpse of our attempt to evolve. And therefore, in spirituality, we must help others to evolve. First of all, you evolve. You become intensely spiritual, humble, kind, compassionate, and not afraid of suffering. That's an important characteristic. If you are afraid of suffering, you can't do anything wonderful. So, mind must help evolution, in my view, through spirituality. Thank you. And just one more thing. You see, evolutionary enlightenment, that is, evolution. In evolution, we are evolving. We are becoming more spiritual. We are getting enlightened. We are a half-baked product in evolution. Thank you.
1969-70, there is a presidential oration by one of the presidents of the Neurology Society of India. That gentleman's talk was on temporal lobe epilepsy. And he said that great religious spiritualists like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, Jesus, Muhammad, etc., they were all having temporal lobe epilepsy. So I was rather puzzled about this and asked Professor V. Balasubramaniam. V. Balasubramaniam is an expert in limbic system and emotions. He told me, Velu, you see, I'm a human being. You see a teratoma. Teratoma is a tumor which has got three layers, the ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm. That means it can have hair, it can produce hair, it can produce tissues, muscle tissues, can produce bone, etc. So a teratoma is not a man. Like that, the spiritual experiences of these great spiritualists are not the temporal lobe seizures. Professor V. Natarajan Jasnam alluded to that. Vasu also said it. A mild stimulation can produce these experiences. Here, a greater stimulation due to disease can produce temporal lobe seizure, where they go again into all these visual and auditory hallucination. They are different. One is disease, other is the experience. But both take origin from the same area. Now it is scientific. And the other thing is what they say is Tirumular, I'll say that in Tamil. Tirumular, olden days, I said, is one of the great saints who produced nice Tamil sentences. And he said, Marathil, Marathai Marathadu, Mamadayane, Marathil Marandadu, Mamadayane, Parathai Marathadu, Parmudal Bodhum, Parathil Marandadu, Parmudal Bodhum. That is, we go to the temple, we see the Vahanam, elephant, horse, etc. Then we enjoy the beauty of the elephant. Then the man who has made it comes. He is a very good teak. He is a very good wood, he says. He doesn't see the elephant, he sees only the wood there. So his vision is different. We are looking at the beauty of the elephant. He looks at the beauty of the teak wood, the strength of the teak wood. Like that, the whole world is Marathi, the Parmudal Bhudam, the Aindhu Bhudangal, that is the water, air, etc., it clouds our consciousness. So we only see the world. We say here is Natarajan, here is Vasu, here is the lamp, etc. But then if you remove all that and see, you see the real God. That is what now Natarajan has alluded to. If you go into that state, you see only the eternal and the super consciousness. Then once when you become one with that, there is no Natarajan, there is no chair, there is no Vasudevan. To me, everybody is equal. So there is no hatred, there is no friendliness. Everybody is friendly. So any man whom come across will be as good to me as Yogaraj. He is a good friend of mine. So the man starts loving everybody, and there is universal brotherhood. Everything is positive. This is my concept about this. And the eye-opener was Professor Balasubramaniam on this matter.
I'm a bit of an outsider here. I'm an architect and a visual communication designer, a good friend of Prabhakar. Thanks, Prabhakar, for inviting me to this conference of such a great group mind that reflects upon mind and spirituality and consciousness. I was fortunate to listen to and discuss with Prabhakar on multiple occasions about brain and consciousness and mind and spiritual experiences through knowing him for the past few years. Thanks for the enlightening talks by such eminent people here. You literally plowed our minds and sowed a lot of nice things today. What I would like to say as a person curiously interested in understanding consciousness and its various dimensions is that any overall philosophy about consciousness will be incomplete until we analyze and properly reconcile these three phenomena concerning consciousness. And I believe the religious and spiritual side of humans, which distinguishes this particular species from all the other species, apart from tool making and symbol making faculty, evolved from one or all of these aspects of consciousness, which gives man a perception of an alternate reality different from the waking consensus reality. So these three aspects which I want to touch upon is are dreams and altered states of consciousness and cognitive anomalies, all of which you touched upon as you spoke. Serious scientific research and many reliable personal testimonies like OBEs and like premonitions and things like that point to certain directions that upset a few deeply held scientific consensus. They point for individuals who have undergone these subjective experiences, and the researchers have studied them, a reality that is essentially non-linear and a consciousness that is non-local. This is what the belief that kind of instills people who are into these kind of things. Turning that the theory that consciousness is an epiphenomenon of matter and like a complexly evolving organized matter upside down. You know, it's kind of points to a separate independent existence of consciousness. That's what these kind of things point out to. So the implications of incorporating these understandings might provide the kind of soul searching in consciousness studies like that which happened at the end of last century among physicists when they confronted quantum mechanics, which upset the apple cart of determinism and certainty of classical physics. So getting into, just touch upon some researchers and what I kind of share some knowledge about what I know on these things. It's like Dream Laboratories, like Maimonides have done some pioneering work in dream research. And like there's a lot of interest generated in like lucid dreaming for like tapping in for creativity and things like that. And many normal individuals are conversant with the like the symbolic language of the dreams, and they derive like guidance and problem resolution, and like some people even claim having premonitions and things like that through dreams. And creative people have always tapped it for inspiration and understanding, whereas psychologists are divided in the Freud, Jung, and transpersonal camp of its interpretation. We need some serious work done in this area through specialist initiative. I do not know any dream realities in this part of the world except for the one in the Andhra University set up by Professor Ramakrishna Rao. And he's a parapsychologist. He worked with J.B. Ryan, who was the founder of Duke Institute of Parapsychology. I think he's the only name from this part of the world who's known, because like spirituality and parapsychology is like, I don't know whether you can call it separate names as such. And the second aspect is the altered state of consciousness, which was traditional shamanic specialization, and later it kind of got into theological domains with or without the use of mind-altering substances. These ego-dissolving, visionary, transcendental states had been the forte of spirituality and mysticism, which again directly influenced various arts. Various techniques like yoga, tantra, and like other transcendental methods have to be verified from a scientific point of view, and the ancient texts corroborated or debunked. So is the need for a qualitative and systematic approach to the states of consciousness induced by certain classes of drugs, including hallucinogens and their modern derivatives. After a lull of few decades post Timothy Leary, this line of research has been seriously taken up by medical researchers like Rick Strassman, and writers like Graham Hancock on the subject of tryptamines especially. And researchers like Benny Shannon speculate upon the relationship between spiritual experiences recorded in the theological texts and these sacred entheogenic substances. We have long associations of such substances with spirituality, right from Vedic Soma to like Eleusinian Kaikion, to like ayahuasca in like Native America, Ibogaine, sacred mushrooms. And you can, the list is endless. And some interesting work is being done in this area by many institutions across the world, including MAPS, Wasiwaka, and a few others in South America, which is in fact an Eldorado of psychopharmacology. Where there's a tendency to just not study these things in a laboratory setting, but it's like kind of given an ethnological and theological dimension apart from a medical perspective as such. So many of you here are aware of the pathological altered states of consciousness apart from theological and pharmacological ones, like the ones reported by the schizophrenics, auditory and visual hallucinations and things like that. And the third aspect of consciousness I want to touch upon is the cognitive anomalies, the so-called paranormal, parapsychological and psychic phenomenon. There are many skeptics than believers in this, as it's very rare and just few bodies involved in pursuing this line of research and like thoughts seriously. And there are far lesser people who have had these experiences given the allowance of deliberate fraud. They range from deja vu, meaningful coincidences called as synchronicity by Carl Jung, and to like telepathy, clairvoyance and precognition, to like full-blown claims of discarnate survival. This line of research in scientific terms have a long history from William James, Mark Twain, Upton Sinclair, Conan Doyle to J.B. Ryan, and pursued by societies like Society of Psychical Research, Princeton Engineering Anomalies Research, Duke University Laboratory of Parapsychology, apart from even military funded projects like Project Stargate, which kind of specialized in trying to have military applications of remote viewing into kind of seeing the enemy's territories. And like we do not know very sure, but only no rumors about the psychic discoveries behind the Iron Curtain of USSR. yeah, USA, maybe there's a lot of deliberate. So we have like less of such initiatives attempted here. I mean, like Ramakrishna Rao has done some work, and I think what Ramachandran, Vilayana Ramachandran did to neuroscience is what Ramakrishna Rao did to parapsychology, according to me. And recently I was very indeed thrilled to read a book by a prolific psychologist of India, Sudhir Kaukar, who had compiled a very interesting book on cognitive anomalies and psi abilities titled aptly called A Seriously Strange.